And it was just another day.
Just another day.
Until I went to the movies, and now it's a movie Tuesday. A movie Tuesday. Until a movie Tuesday.
Yellow, and welcome to Movie Tuesday. Long story short, Movie Tuesday is where I watch movies, and I'll tell you if they're worth seeing or not. Case closed. Let's get to the news, shall we? Ben Affleck. In the last video, I'm pretty sure it was the last video, I was talking about how he had went on record to say that he was not sure if he was going to be directing the Batman solo movie. Well, shortly after that, it was confirmed that Ben Affleck will be directing the Batman solo movie. Further, driving home, my whole thing where I don't know what the hell is going on over at WB with their DC movies and their cinematic universe. No idea what's going on. No idea if there's kind of like, if there's no power struggle or anything like that. Which, if there's no power struggle, that's good. We don't need any beef in Hollywood, okay? There's enough beef going on. We don't need any more beef. But yes, he's confirmed to be the director for the Batman solo movie. So that's great. I like Ben Affleck. I like his directing style. I like the movies that he's directed. He's great. Remember last video when I was also saying that at the end of the day, I just want them to get him a better looking suit. I was kind of on the same page as Ben Affleck, because he also said that since he is going to be directing and acting in the movie, he needs a better Batman outfit. Not a better looking outfit, just a better Batman outfit. Because basically, he needs to like be able to jump back and forth in front of and in back of the camera to like set up the shots and make sure everything's being done right. So, completely understand that. That's one of the many problems with superhero movies, is that they always make these elaborate costumes and they may look great on camera, but they are not great to wear the majority of the time. So he's going to need something a little bit more maneuverable, because I'm guessing he's planning on like shooting a scene, jumping out of suit, getting behind the camera and checking shit out. Or if he's just going to like shoot the scene and keep the suit on because it's so comfortable, and jump in back of the camera and check things out and blah, blah, blah. And that's a kind of a funny picture that I have in my head right now of him just like sitting in a director's chair with his like full Batman garb on. Just like, action! It's like, cut, let's do that again. It's like, I don't know, like, I just imagine him getting like super pissed off or something at a scene, and he's just got his full Batman suit on, just everybody around him just can't take him seriously just because he's just sitting there in his Batman outfit. I don't know, it's just, I'm weird like that, but that's great, man. Ben Affleck is directing Batman. Cool. Other news with DC and WB madness. The Rock has finally sat down and started having meetings with the WB or with DC. I'm pretty sure both of all the execs are in the room having meetings with him. I found this to be really weird, because if memory serves me correct, they announced that The Rock was going to play Black Adam like 2 years ago. I would say 2 years tops. And the fact that they're just now having talks about him playing the character, like, I guess, like what he's going to do or what the outfit's going to look like, is just kind of weird. Just announcing that he's going to be this character, that you would have had some kind of talks with him, at least over the phone, like some kind of meeting about what it was going to entail with him playing that role. I didn't even know they were still doing a Shazam movie. When they first announced like all the movies that they were going to do, like they announced solo movies for Cyborg, they announced solo movies for Aquaman, they announced solo movies for Shazam, and you know, and then once the and they did all this like before Batman v Superman came out. And once that movie rolled out and once Suicide Squad rolled out and they kind of weren't doing that great critically, that's when DC started to kind of like, I feel like that's when they started to kind of pull back and be like, all right, like, let's not talk about these obscure characters right now. Let's focus on trying to fix whatever we can to get ready for Justice League movie and the Wonder Woman movie and all that stuff. And I assume that they just scrapped the Shazam movies and stuff like that, because when I, like I said earlier, when they announced that they were going to do a Cyborg movie, they announced a Flash movie and a Cyborg movie, like two separate movies. And then they had eventually like changed their mind and were like, well, we're just going to do like a buddy movie where it's the Flash. Like, they'll do a Flash movie and Cyborg will show up, but they weren't going to do like a Cyborg movie or something. That was what I heard. I could be wrong, but the last I heard about a Cyborg movie was that he was just going to show up in the Flash movie and they were going to do like a little buddy type thing for that. So, like I said, no idea what's going on over at Warner Brothers with these movies, you know. There's also news that they're changing up the tone, the overall tone of the movies. Like, they don't want to do the whole dark, gritty, gloomy tone anymore that Man of Steel and Batman v Superman had. Now they want to get more whimsical and optimistic and shit, like Marvel movies, you know. And I don't know, I think it's kind of a mistake. I think they should just do their own thing. Just fuck the haters. You're making your money. You know, it may not be like astronomical revenue like the Marvel movies are making, but just do your own thing. I've said from the beginning, when they first had announced that they were doing the shared universe like Marvel, is that DC was screwed either way. They were gonna get shit if they copied Marvel's formula to a T, and they were gonna get shit if they did their own thing, which is the route that they chose to do. And lo and behold, they're getting shit for it. And now people are kind of like coming out of woodwork saying, well, they should just do what Marvel did. It's like, yeah, okay, because you wouldn't have given them shit if they would have did what Marvel did. It's like, get out of here. So yeah, just don't know what's going on. David S. Goyer is confirmed as the writer and producer for the Green Lantern Corps movie. You know, like I said, I thought that got scrapped. I thought they were trying to stay as far away as they could from the Green Lantern after the whole Ryan Reynolds movie, which I didn't mind. It wasn't as bad as everybody made out to be. Like, that's the thing with DC movies, is I think a lot of people blow those movies out of proportion, man. That's probably why I end up liking them, is because I go in with such low expectations that when I sit down and actually watch the movie for myself and gather my own opinion on it, I'm just kind of sitting there just like, huh, like, I see what's going on, I'm seeing what people aren't feeling, but I don't feel as strongly about it as they do, you know. It's like, it's still an entertaining movie. And I don't know, maybe it's just because I'm not like a diehard DC fan. Like, I prefer Marvel to DC. Like, I'm more closer with the Marvel characters than I am with the DC characters, so maybe that's what it has to do. So, like, when I go see a Green Lantern movie, it's like, I don't know what I'm looking for. I don't know what's accurate. I don't know what's true and what's not true. I don't know, like, what they pulled out of their ass and what they pulled from the comics. So, at the end of the day, I just want to see a good movie, and I thought the Green Lantern movie was all right. But, obviously, the people didn't like it, and that must have hurt DC, because, like I said, I thought they were just trying to stay as far away from that property as they could, but apparently, you know, they're bringing out the big guns. You know, David S. Goyer, Dark Knight trilogy, come on now. You know, he got them DC roots, so we'll see what he can do. Jeff Johns is going to be executive producing it. I have no idea what that means. I heard from another movie podcast called Keeping It Real a while back, where they were saying that the executive producer title is not always as big as you think it is. Like, you know, you would think like executive producer, you're thinking of somebody like Stan Lee, where like they have the final say on stuff. Like, he's the type of person where when he's an executive producer, they could like show him an entire movie, like finished, edited, put together, and if he sits down, watches it, and is like, nope, this isn't gonna work, they will change that shit. Like, that kind of executive producing, right? But there's also the executive producers where I've heard that they could go and get coffee for the director and they could get their name in the credits as an executive producer. So if that's true, hook your boy up on the movie scene so I can go and get somebody some coffee so I can see my name up on the big screen when the credits roll and it's like executive produced by me. Like, that's me. That's me right there. That's my name. Like, that'd be cool. So, like I said, man, I don't know what's going on over there at WB. At this point, I'm just sitting back, maxing and relaxing, and seeing what happens. So, on the other news, the Uncharted movie, the script for it has been completed. I have no idea how long they've been working on the script. I'm going to say a long-ass time because this movie has been talked about or in the background for a minute. And I'm talking about, like, years minute. So, the fact they're just now finishing the script is kind of crazy. I'm pretty sure that we're going to be hearing about casting soon. Until I hear about some casting, taking everything that I hear about the Uncharted movie with a grain of salt. Already put Chris Pratt's name in the hat to be Nathan Drake. I think he can pull it off. But doing a little bit of thinking, I was thinking like Chris Pratt's kind of busy right now. Chris Pratt is so hot right now, Chris Pratt, that it might start to get a little annoying to see his face on everything. I mean, you got Jurassic World, you got Guardians of the Galaxy, and that sequel's getting ready to come out pretty soon. What else? He just did Passengers last year. So, Chris Pratt's a busy man. So, in case people will experience screen fatigue if he gets announced as Nathan Drake, I'll put in my second choice for, Nathan Drake. And in fact, when I think about this, I actually want him to be my first choice now. So now I'm taking out Chris Pratt's name and I'm putting in Liam McIntyre. If you don't know who Liam McIntyre is, Liam McIntyre was Spartacus in the Spartacus show on Stars. He was the replacement after Andy Whitfield passed away. And Liam McIntyre is a great actor. I like him. He's got the looks. He's got the chops. Now, I don't know what his skills are as far as like disguising his voice. I've only seen him in Spartacus, and I've seen him on The Flash, and I've heard him in Gears of War 4. He's the main character in Gears of War, J.D. Phoenix. And I can't remember if I can hear his accent in those other projects outside of Spartacus. Because, like, you can kind of hear his accent, because you know he's Australian. So if he can hide it, I would put him in the ring to be Nathan Drake. In fact, I'm pretty sure, I don't know, I gotta go back and look at his previous work, but if he can hide his Australian accent, I think he can pull off Nathan Drake. So yeah, I'm gonna put Liam McIntyre's name in the hat. You know, Chris Pratt, you got enough going on for you. You're on a hot streak. You're on a heater, okay? You don't need any more work. You're good. You know, you got the Marvel checks, all right? You probably haven't even cashed the Marvel checks. That's how much money you're probably sitting on right now. So, like, I'm sorry, but I'm going to take you out, put Liam McIntyre in there. Another good choice that I heard, and I don't want to take credit for this. I'm going to give credit to my boy, Gabe Patillo, from the podcast Married to the Games. He suggested doing or using Bradley Cooper. That would be good too. Like, when I think about it and I think about his role in the A-Team movie, I'm like, Bradley Cooper could pull it off. But see, we run into the same thing with in Chris Pratt's camp where they get the Marvel checks, okay? And Bradley Cooper has been really, really busy. I would say he's probably been more busier than Chris Pratt. You know, Bradley Cooper's been popping up in a lot of stuff. But yeah, I still think that would be a good choice. Like, he's got the look. So those three guys I'm looking at to be Nathan Drake, but I want Liam McIntyre, and you all should too, because he's the man. Okay. So that's that. Last bit of news, pretty big news. Shane Black is supposedly making a new Predator movie, simply titled The Predator. Good news is that it's not a reboot. It's supposed to take place, or not directly after the first two Predator movies, but like it's gonna be like Robert Rodriguez's Predators movie, where it's like all those previous movies still happened. This is just like a side story that's happening. But like, this apparently is supposed to be like a mainline Predator movie, like Predator 3, pretty much, right? For those who don't know who Shane Black is, I think, like, what? His most recent work was... he did Iron Man 3, of course, but he did some after that, too. He did The Nice Guys. That was actually a really good movie. He did The Nice Guys. Shane Black is dope. I like Shane Black. For those who don't know, because I just found this out recently as well, he was in the first Predator movie. He was Hawkins. Hawkins! The guy with the glasses, got dragged into the tree and skinned alive, or whatever. He was that guy. That was Shane Black. That was crazy. That was a big revelation for me when I found that out. But, yeah. So, he's making a new Predator movie. And so far, just based off of the cast that he's having in it, this movie sounds amazing, okay? I don't know if it's going to be amazing, but it sounds amazing. They're talking about having Arnie come back and playing why can't I remember his name? What was the name of the movie? It's not Dylan. That was Carl Weathers. What the fuck was his name? Damn it. That's going to kill me now. Anyway, Arnie is supposed to be reprising his role again. And then 50 Cent's supposed to be in it. I don't think 50 Cent is like the greatest actor in the world, but I like to see him on screen. I like to see him doing his movie thing, because, you know, I've seen a lot of the projects he's done, and he's really serious about the whole acting situation. So, like, I want to support him when I can. So the fact that he's going to be in the movie as of right now, from what I've heard, that's great. Who else is supposed to be in the movie? Arnold Schwarzenegger, 50 Cent, Olivia Munn is supposed to be in there. I love me some Olivia Munn. You know, so just based off of that, and Shane Black directing it, probably even producing it, probably even writing it. Don't know. I just know he's directing it. Sounds like it's going to be a great movie. And I want to move on, because I'm still thinking about what Arnold's name was in that movie, and it's really killing me right now. But what I want to know is, like, are they going to completely erase Robert Rodriguez's movie? I don't think they need to, because honestly, like, I like that movie. I thought it was pretty good. And like I said, it's more of like a side kind of story in the Predator universe, which I think works pretty well. So hopefully they don't like do a Disney and just like banish that out of existence, you know? So we'll see. I need to get more information, but so far sounds like a great movie. Let's see. That about does it for the news. Let's get on to the trailers. Still thinking about that Arnold thing. Man, I feel so bad right now. Resident Evil, the final chapter, is coming. It's coming, guys. It actually comes out this week. And I am very excited. I'm not joking around. I'm very excited for this movie. It's the last Resident Evil movie. till they reboot it or some shit like that. But I've seen the previews for it. It looks like it's going to pick up where the last movie left off. Can't remember what it was called. I think it was called Revelations. It was Afterlife, wasn't it? I think it was Afterlife. I don't know. We're going to go with Afterlife. It looks like it's picking up right where that movie left off, which was her, Mila Jovovich, and I can't remember if it was Chris Redfield or not, but I remember, like, Alice and Wesker, like, kind of teaming up, and I'm pretty sure they were at the White House, and they were getting ready to launch, like, this full-scale war against, like, all these zombies and mutant monsters and shit like that. So, that's good, because one of the problems that those movies have been having since after the second movie was that they, like, end the last movie off somewhere, and you figure they're going to pick up the next movie where that left off, but then, like, there's all this time that passed. Like, with Resident Evil Extinction, like, there's all this shit that happened that I wish they would have shown that would have made that movie a little bit better, I feel. And I don't know. Maybe they won't pick up where they left off. Maybe they'll pick up, like, in the middle of the battle or some shit like that. But so far from what I've seen with the flying bat thing flying around, which is where the last movie ended, like, it looks like they're picking up where they left off. So great. I'm pretty sure I've said it before. I mean, the Resident Evil movies, the first movie is, like, the one that I, like, really, really liked. Everything after that is just okay. It's, like, fun action popcorn-y shit. I'm not expecting much from this movie coming up. I just want to see Mila Jovovich kick the shit out of zombies and mutant monsters, you know? And that's it. That's all I want. And that's why I'm excited for it. Because, honestly, I haven't really been seeing her doing much lately. I need to go and check her her filmography on Wiki, but I haven't seen her doing much. I would assume that she's just busy being a mom. You know, she's cashing in those Resident Evil checks, and she's taking the kids to soccer practice, you know, while Paul W.S. Anderson writes the script for his Monster Hunter movie. I don't know. The most recent thing that I remember her being in that wasn't Resident Evil was that movie Stone with Edward Norton and Robert De Niro. So I'm excited to see her on the screen again. You know, you need to do more stuff, Mila. I mean, if you don't want to, that's cool, but, you know, I just want to see you beat the shit out of people. That's all I want. It's not asking a lot, is it? Maybe it is, because, you know, you got to work out, you got to do choreography and all that, and training. It's just, I understand if you don't want to do it anymore. But, yeah, Resident Evil, final chapter, going to see it this weekend, actually, going to see it. Fistfight. This movie looks hilarious. I love Ice Cube. I love Charlie Day. They're both in the movie together. That's an odd pairing, but I'm into it. It looks great. It looks like it's going to be funny. Got mad respect for Ice Cube. That man is, like, changed. That man has evolved so hard. Like, you know, he's done the gangster roles. He's done the family roles. He's done the action hero roles, you know, Triple X, you know. Speaking of which, I saw him pop up in the latest preview for that Triple X movie, Return of Xander Cage. Remember when I talked about that trailer and I was a little upset that they didn't have Ice Cube's character in it? He's in it. They showed him, and I was very happy, and I was like, yes! So I can't wait for that movie to come out either. In fact, I think that movie comes out this week as well. It's either this week or next week. But I'm going to see that as well. Got Ice Cube. Got Vin Diesel. Got Ruby Rose. Let's do this. But, yeah. Fistfight. Going to go see it. Fun fact. It comes out on Michael Jordan's birthday. It's fate, people. Michael Jordan's my idol, if you didn't know. So, that's why it's a big deal for me. Rings. I saw the preview for Rings. This isn't the first time I've seen the preview for Rings. I saw it a long time ago. By long time ago, I mean a year ago. And that preview looked like garbage. The effects looked garbage. The movie looked garbage. I couldn't even tell what the hell was going on in the trailer to tell what the movie was about. Which is not always a bad thing, you know, because I've seen, like, trailers for other shit, like that trailer, A Cure for Wellness. Like, I didn't know what the hell was going on in that, but the movie still looked good. But in the case of Rings, the movie looked like shit. And guess what? I ended up being right, because they ended up delaying that movie last year, because it was supposed to come out last year, and they delayed it to do reshoots and to fix things. And that was one of those news items where, or movie news, where they said that they were going to do reshoots and stuff, where I actually agree with it. And I was like, great, because that movie looked like shit. The new trailer came out, and now the movie actually looks pretty interesting. It looks like the Samara chick has moved on to the internet, where she's passing out videos on the internet now. So that's pretty cool. You don't know or not, but The Ring, the first Ring movie, the American one, scared the shit out of me. Because back in those days, I used to use a lot of VHS tapes to record Simpsons episodes, right? And I started out labeling them, but then eventually when I got into like the 20s, it just got to the point where I just ripped off labels from other tapes and put them in there and recorded them and filled them up and took the tapes and shot them somewhere. So I had like a whole bunch of like blank tapes sitting around with the labels torn off and everything. And The Ring changed that. It made it so I didn't want to watch blank tapes anymore, because if I put a blank tape in a VCR and the whole bunch of white noise came on and the whole like ear pinching scream came, whatever like that, I'd freak the fuck out. So I stopped watching blank tape movies. So maybe this movie is gonna make me freak the fuck out when there's weird movies on YouTube or weird videos on YouTube that pop up, and it's, and I'm gonna be like, nah, man, I'm not clicking on that shit right there, you know what I'm saying? So I don't know, but movie looks pretty interesting now. I'm glad everything looks like it's working out. I'm not going to say it. I'm glad everything worked out, because I haven't seen the movie yet. The movie could still be shit. Because, let's be honest here, The Ring 2, that movie was shit. First one was good. Second one was shit. So, hopefully, they can redeem themselves with this one. And, that's about it for the trailers. Now, let's get on to the movies. Shall we? Ladies and gentlemen, I regret to inform you, for the first time in Movie Tuesday history, I have not been to the movies to see a movie. Since 2017 has started, I have not been to the theaters. I've been a lazy shit. Been working on some videos, still working on the Movie of the Year video for Movie Tuesday. I'm working on a video game of the year video for a different series. It's craziness. I've been on this weird anime kick lately. Like, I finished up some anime late last year, and then I just kept on going, and I haven't stopped. I'm behind on everything. I'm behind on movies. I'm behind on games. I'm behind on TV. It's a clusterfuck, and I apologize. But I have still seen some movies at home. And one of those is Paranormal Activity Ghost Dimension. So, brief synopsis, and stop me if you've heard this one. So, there's this family, and they're in this house, and the dad is all into video cameras. I guess he's like some kind of videographer or whatever like that. And during, you know, around the Christmas holidays, he starts going through some boxes to get more decorations, I think. And he stumbles upon a weird camera in the box with videotapes. And he starts using said weird camera to film stuff. And he starts noticing like weird things in the camera that he sees, right? And some weird stuff starts happening around the house, so naturally he sets up cameras around the house to capture everything, and they spend the entire movie, like, disregarding what's happening pretty much, and then, you know, the movie ends. So, basically what I'm trying to say is that this Paranormal Activity movie is the same as all the other Paranormal Activity movies. I used to be really into this franchise. I think the first movie was just, I'm not going to say perfect, but I really enjoyed the first movie. That movie scared the shit out of me. I still remember going to the theaters to see it, and after I got out, I had to go stay at my cousin's house, because at the time, I was living in an apartment by myself, and I was so scared after seeing that movie, I had to go sleep at her house. You know, so I wouldn't be alone. I was freaked out, you know, and I was happy because that hasn't happened to me in a long time. And, you know, I went to go see the second movie, and the second movie is where I stopped going to the theaters to see those movies, because the second movie was pretty much pound for pound the first movie, just a couple more scares here and there, lots of jump scares, like cheap jump scares, you know. And ever since then, I've just been, like, waiting until they came on, like, cable or, like, streaming services. Actually, no, that's a lie, because I went to go see the Marked ones in theaters, but that wasn't my fault. One of my friends wanted to go see it in the theater, so I had to go, reluctantly. But, yeah, so, like, the first one was good, and I gotta run through all these real quick, because apparently Ghost Dimension is the last Paranormal Activity movie. That's what they say. The last. So, like, the first one was good. That was the best one. Second one was kind of lame. Third one, I actually really liked. I surprisingly really liked the third movie. Not as much as I liked the first one, but still good. And honestly, they could have stopped after the third one. Because, you know, in the third one, it kind of is a prequel to Before Everything, where it, like, talks about how the girls got to have the whole demon Toby, like, following them around, right? The fourth one was not that great. Could have did without seeing that. The fifth one, which was the Marked ones, was decent. And that one was decent at first because it kind of, like, started kind of telling, like, a side story a little bit, but it eventually looped around to the main plot of the overall series. The fifth one is also where they completely lost me, because then they introduced time travel. And then we get to the sixth one, which is the Ghost Dimension, which is hopefully the last one. The problem with this movie is the same problem with all the movies after the first one, is just that they follow that same formula, like, over and over, where it's just this slow build up to the end where everything just starts to go down. So that was, like, one of my gripes with the Ghost Dimension movie. And the problem with that is I appreciate them, like, bringing everything together, per se, where they're trying to build up this story. And I get it, but at the same time, it's like, you would think, even with the movies kind of, like, going out of order, you would think that the movies that take place in the present day, the ghost would be a lot stronger, or the demon would be a lot stronger that's fucking with the family. But it seems like every single movie, it's almost like the demon starts over from square one, to where he's slowly got to build up his power to fuck with the family in the house. And I just find that annoying. The other thing I find annoying with these movies is that the characters are fucking stupid. Like, the first movie, like I said, was not perfect, but it made sense, to where the whole purpose of these films with these characters for setting up cameras around the house is that weird shit is going on in the house. So they set up the cameras to capture it, right? And the first movie kind of makes sense because it starts out where it's just, like, doors creaking open and, you know, some sounds downstairs that the camera doesn't capture. It captures the sound, but not, like, what's actually making the sound. Like, so I picture when the guy wakes up and goes back and watches that video footage of like doors just kind of like opening and shit like that. Okay, you know, that shit, you can look at it and be like, okay, yeah, like it's just the wind, it's the AC blowing the door open, stuff like that, you know? But like, when you start having like Ouija boards catch on fire and footprints that clearly aren't human walking along the floor and you don't see what's making the footprints, you just see them appear on the floor, it's time to do something, people. And that was the first movie. And the movies progressively get worse with their characters with shit happening. It's like, if I record my bedroom throughout the night while I sleep and the door opens by itself, I'm gonna chalk that up to the AC blowing the door open, right? But if I record my kitchen and I see my girlfriend in the kitchen just kind of like looking around because she thought she heard something, and then all of a sudden every single cabinet door opens in the kitchen at the same time, I'm not going to disregard that. I'm not going to think, oh, it's just the AC. There must have been some kind of buildup somewhere and it all just came rushing out through the kitchen cabinets. It's like, no, dude. Like, I don't want to spoil this movie for you, but I'm just going to tell you just how stupid the characters are in this movie, right? So, like I said, the guy sits with the camera around his house. Naturally, the little girl, his daughter, is the one who's interacting with the fucking demon, right? So there's a scene where he's got two cameras in his daughter's bedroom while she sleeps. He's got the weird camera that he found in the box that captures all the ghostly shit. And he's got like a regular camera that he uses to film everyday stuff, right? So there's one night where there's literally black ooze coming from under his daughter's bed and sitting over her while she sleeps. And it takes like the form of a person. The weird camera that he found is capturing all of this, right? The normal camera is capturing nothing. It just shows his daughter sleeping in bed. And eventually the daughter gets up and starts talking to the black ooze monster from under the bed. The ghost camera's capturing all this shit. The regular camera is not. It's capturing a little girl talking to thin air, right? So the next day, he's like telling his wife what happened, and they're calm as fuck, dude. He's all like, yeah, so like, I was recording last night, and there was like this weird black substance that came out from under so-and-so's bed, and it was like standing over her, and it looked like it took the shape of a person. And his wife is just like, maybe there's just something wrong with the camera. Like, are you fucking kidding me right now, dude? Like, how dense, how dumb can you be? Like, like, I literally just shaking my head like, dude, I can't deal with this. I can't deal with these stupid characters anymore, right? So like, that shit, dude, I'm tired of it, and I'm glad that they stopped. I wanted them to stop after three. When I went to go watch The Marked Ones, which was the fifth movie, the one before the Ghost Dimension movie that I'm talking about, I thought they should have stopped right there, because in that movie, and, you know, I can give you a spoiler warning, but obviously if you haven't seen that movie by now, you're probably never going to see it. But in that movie, they introduced time travel, where it's like there's time portals that people can walk through and go back to the past. So like, The Marked Ones ends where the first movie, the first Paranormal Activity ends, right? It goes to that scene at what happened in that moment. And then the movie cuts off. Seriously, I got up in the theater and I was like, all right, dude, y'all can stop now, okay? Y'all done. Y'all just came back to the first movie. You explained the little girls and shit and why the demons are fucking with them and all this. Like, I got it. Stop. And then they did this movie to where they bring it all to one culmination of what it was all building up to. And I'm telling you right now, it wasn't worth it. It wasn't worth it at all, you know? And I'm sorry, but when it comes to time travel, dude, it's just, I can't deal most of the time, man. It's bad. Time travel introduces contradictions. Even when you have people that like plan that shit down to a T, there's contradictions, there's loops going around, and every time with me, when time travel is introduced, 9 times out of 10, I'm just sitting there just like, whatever, dude. All right, cool. Yeah, you did this. You went back and did this, and that's why this is happening. So I got you. Yeah, you know, it's just, it's annoying and it sucks, you know. And this movie embraces it full on. But the problem with this movie franchise is that they introduced time travel like late in the game, you know, like it was one of those things where I feel like it's one of those lost moments, you know, where they've built up so many questions with the franchise that when it finally came time to bring everything to a climax, they were kind of just scratching their heads and it was like, time travel? Like, it's just, ugh. So, with that being said, dude, like, I wouldn't waste my time with this movie, okay? If you're a Paranormal Activity fan, you've already seen it, and let me know if you liked it or not, because I didn't like this movie. It was a waste of time, and if I would have went to go see this in theaters, I would have been fucking pissed, okay? So, yeah, man, stay away from this movie. Like, I can't even see myself just having this movie on in the background. Do not recommend watching Paranormal Activity, Ghost Dimension. And I'll put this out there, too. If you're a Paranormal Activity fan, if you understood what the hell was going on in that movie, hit me up and explain it to me, because I don't get it. And the main reason why I don't get it is because of the whole time travel thing. Now, getting to the next movie also involves time travel. The movie is Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. It's a very hard title to remember. This was one of those movies where I really wanted to see it in the theaters, but I just kept putting it off, you know, and then next thing I knew, it was on pay-per-view, so I ended up watching it there, which is why, like I told you a couple videos back, one of my resolutions for movies this year is just when it's time to go see a movie, when I have a chance to go see a movie, I'm going to do it. I don't care how tired I am. I don't care how lazy I feel. I'm going to do it, because this was one of those movies that I really wanted to see in theaters, and I watched it at home, and it's one of those movies as well where I was like, I really wish I would have saw that in theaters, because I enjoyed the movie. It met my expectations, and that's really rare. Usually, like, I go to a movie with high expectations and it doesn't quite meet it. I go into a movie with low expectations and it's more than what I thought it was going to be. It's very rare that I anticipate a movie just being like so-so, and I go in and I'm like, it was so-so. It was good. It's just a good movie. Not too good, not too bad, just good. And that's saying a lot, because like I said, this movie involves time travel. So, give you a quick synopsis for this movie. There's a kid who grew up with his grandpa telling him stories about this place that he used to visit, where it's run by this woman who has the power to control time, and she can change it to a bird. Her name is Miss Peregrine. And she has this house that harbors these children who have, like, powers, right? So, think of, like, X-Men and Xavier. In fact, that was, like, my subtitle, like, my code name for this movie. When I first saw the previews for it, I was like, looks like Tim Burton's X-Men, you know? And that's exactly what it is. So, this kid grew up with his grandpa telling him these stories about, you know, kids who could harbor bees inside their body and shoot them out at will, and, you know, kids who were so light that they had to wear lead boots, otherwise they would have floated off into wherever. And so the kid grows up hearing all these stories, and for the longest he thinks they're true, but as he gets older, he starts to kind of like just say, oh, you know, like, those are just stories, and my grandpa's just old and senile or whatever, right? Until one day, his grandpa is mysteriously murdered. And he's murdered in the same fashion as the stories that he described to this kid, who is played by Asa Butterfield. You may know him from Ender's Game. That's where I know him from. So his grandpa's mysteriously murdered, and he sets out trying to figure out what the hell happened, because it's weird how he died. He saw like a weird creature, like the things that he saw matches what his grandpa told him. So he's starting to like kind of question whether those stories were true or not. He stumbles upon this letter written to his grandpa from Miss Peregrine, and the date on it is like recent. And I think like they had made it out to believe that she had died like years ago, or like maybe even like centuries ago or some shit. Like, I don't know. She was thought to be dead. But he found this letter that was written to his grandpa recently from her. So he set out to go and find her and figure out what the hell happened to his grandpa. And lo and behold, he enters into this whole world of, you know, procure your children stuff and, you know, evil forces trying to kill him and take over the world and everything like that. So that's a general synopsis, and I enjoyed the movie. Ava Green plays Miss Peregrine, and I don't know what it is about that woman, but every time I look at her, I get into a trance. She is a phenomenal actress. Like, man, she's amazing. And one of my biggest gripes with the movie, and this is like self-inflicted when you think about it, but one of my biggest gripes was that she wasn't in the movie enough. I went in there thinking that she was going to be one of the main characters that they showed, like that she would get a lot of screen time. And I didn't think she did. And, you know, I figured like, you know, with her name being the first thing in the title that, you know, they would focus on her a lot more, but they didn't. But then, like I said, it's self-inflicted because the movie is called Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. So it's about the children. Luckily, the children live up to the weight of the story, you know, since it centers around them. Like, all the kids and their weird powers and stuff are good. The actors who play them are good. They're believable. I sympathize with them. I relate to them. You know, I can get behind them. I'm invested in them, you know. It's all good. The effects are good. I thought there was a nice balance of practical and digital effects. You know how I love that. I thought the story was good. Even though it involved time travel, I still enjoyed the story. I still kind of ran into the problem near the end where, you know, they're kind of like jumping in and out of time. And I could explain it, but, you know, maybe you should just check the movie out and figure out what the fuck I'm talking about, you know, maybe. But at the end of the day, I still followed it. And basically, you know, like, I'm not a stickler. You know, if there's time travel involved, it's not like I turn my back on and don't have anything to do with it. It's very complicated for me. Like I said, I try and follow this shit. You know, a lot of movies do a really good job at setting up the laws of their time travel and time manipulation. But then there's like a point in the movie where everything's just like going all over the place. And I'm just kind of sitting there just like, all right, okay, guys, you know, like whatever. But it was good. I thought it was good. Besides the Ava Green gripe, another gripe I had was Asa Butterfield. I'm going to have to check his IMDb, because the only movie that I know him from or that I've seen him in was Ender's Game. And I liked him in Ender's Game, but in this movie, I didn't particularly like his performance. I just think like he's really flat and really stale. And I don't know if that's how he really is in person or what. All I know is that it's like in Ender's Game, it fit. Like him being like really standoffish and antisocial and stuff and kind of being a dick, it fit for that movie. But in this movie, it's kind of like a watered down version from Ender's Game. And I just didn't really care for it. Like I wasn't sold on a lot of his reactions and the way he was handling situations in the movie. It's not to the point where I can't stand to watch him in this movie. It's just like there's some scenes where I'm just kind of less like, dude, like, could you have a little bit more life, you know? And I mean it, because the funny thing is that he was actually one of the candidates to be the next Spider-Man in the Marvel movies. And I was judging off of Ender's Game, I kind of wanted to give him a chance. And I was like, yeah, like, get him. He's a little scrawny looking dude. He's not like super fucking hot like Andrew Garfield. You know, get like a basic looking guy, right? And I was going to give him the benefit of the doubt and say, like, you know, he was pretty, like, standoffish or pretty stale in Ender's Game, but maybe he's got, like, this fucking bubbly personality or whatever that he can pull off with Spider-Man. And I'm glad they didn't pick him, you know? Like, good choice with Tom Holland, Marvel. Like, kudos to you. But other than that, like, he did okay. He's not, like, terrible. It's just, like, I don't know. I just felt like he could have put a little bit more oomph in his performance. So, long story short, I thought the movie was good. I think you should check it out when you get a chance. It's on pay-per-view right now. Well, I think it's still on pay-per-view. But if it's not, I'd say go give it a rent. It should be coming on cable pretty soon if it's not on pay-per-view. So when you see it pop up on the movie guide, I'd say give it a whirl, dude. It's actually a pretty entertaining movie. In fact, I'm probably gonna end up adding that to my video collection. And that's about it, man. Like I said, I haven't been to the theaters, you know, but I'm gonna change that this week. I'm gonna play catch up, and the next video I'm gonna hit you with that new shit. You know, with that Resident Evil for sure, because I'm going to see that this weekend. So, yeah, man, I'll be back for that. Still working on the movie of the year stuff. I think I finally got the format laid out on how I want to do it, how I want to present it. I was gonna try and get like a nice little location where I could do it, spruce it up a little bit, separate it from all these videos, but I'll probably just end up doing that next year. Right now, I just want to like get it laid out and get a format done. If I would have went with my original idea, the video probably would have ended up being like 8 hours or some shit, and it don't need to be that long. So, just gotta get things recorded. You know, the notes are done. Just gotta get it recorded, get it edited, and then get it posted. I'm shooting for a deadline of about the end of January, you know, no later than early February, but it should be out early or late January. So be on the lookout for that. Till then, that was Movie Tuesday. Now it's just another day.
And it was just another day. Yeah.
Just another day.
Until it went to the movies, and now it's a movie Tuesday. A movie Tuesday. Until a movie Tuesday.
It was Dutch. Dutch. That was Arnold Schwarzenegger's character in the Predator movie. Dutch. Yes, I delayed this video just to come back and tell you that, because it just was not sitting right with me. No, I didn't Google it. Sheer willpower alone helped me remember what that character's name was.